YouTube. A few weeks ago, a fellow YouTuber named Ken wrote to ClydeSight about a unique machine that he has, which is not properly functioning. It's made by Montgomery Ward, and it is a very early Walkman-style tape player. Ken sent me some pictures of the unit so that I could take a look and make an assessment based on what I saw in the pictures. And I told him I thought I could probably repair it for him if he wanted to send it to me. So here it is. He put it in a priority mailbox the way I asked, and it is all set. It came today, and we're going to open it up and take a look. And of course, first thing we see is he sent a note. And he says, Dear Tim, enclosed is a cassette Walkman we discussed through the email. To the best of my knowledge, everything works fine on this unit except the forward and rewind functions. When selecting either of these two, the tape does not move, but you can hear the motor running. That's why I suspect that the belts that drive these functions have gone bad. I did not open the unit to check this out. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact me. I look forward to hearing from you. So, of course, I sent Ken an email the minute the box arrived to let him know it got here safely, and I'm going to make an examination of the unit now. And we have these lovely little packing peanuts in here, which I'm going to try and keep from losing because I will use them to reship the product back to him. And there's a tape player in here. I can find it. Here it is. And let's clean off these packing things. And we will now move the box out of the way and see what we can find out. Now, Ken did something very nice and practical here. When he wrapped the tape in bubble wrap, he used masking tape to seal it. That makes it very easy for me to know where the tape seals are so I can lift the tape off and open the bubble wrap. Thus, I'll be able to reuse it. I have the machine all unwrapped now, and it looks to be cosmetically in very, very good shape. Everything's nice and clean. There are not really many scratches here. Everything seems to be here that I can see. Let's take a look at what's here. Obviously, here is the cassette door, and it's very much like a standard cassette tape recorder from the 1960s or early 70s, although I know this machine had to come later than that. We can see there's some screws here to hold it together. On the back here, there is nothing except for the battery compartment cover here. There's a tone switch on this side. And in the back here, we see the label that tells us about it, and some more screws, plus a DC 6-volt input so that you could use an adapter with it. And up here, we see the controls. And what we have here, have to turn it upside down, we have here, here's the play, here's the rewind, here's the fast forward, here's a stop, here are the volume controls, they're sliders. And they're kind of nice, they've got little markers here so that you can tell how far you're using this, although it's kind of obvious how far you're using it just by where it is. And it has two headphones, which was a concept that they came up with in the 80s because people wanted to share their musical experiences. So this allowed two people to listen to the same tape at the same time. As long as neither one of them went too far away from each other, they both could enjoy the same player. So that's kind of good. So the battery compartment opens by flipping this lid down, and the thing will swing open like that. This way you'll never lose the battery compartment cover, and that's a nice touch. Also, although you can't see it, but on the inside there are four springs, and they're marked positive and negative. So the batteries are in the unit, and I'm going to just press, without a tape, we'll just press the start button, and I can see that the spindle is turning here, so I know that there's power getting to it. And if I push fast forward, it's kind of trying to turn. I see what Ken is talking about. And if I push rewind, there's no function at all. Okay, now I wonder if this has cue and review. So I put it into play, and I push down the fast forward. Well, it's trying to cue, and if I do rewind, well, it's trying, but not much is happening. So the next step would be to put a tape in, make sure at least it will play back. To test this for sound so that you can hear it, I've hooked up these two speakers here. And I put a tape in the machine, and I plug the stereo line into the headphone jack. And this is a cassette of my own. It is a Symphonia Felina music cassette that I sell, and the reason I'm using that is to get away from any copyright issues with YouTube. I own the music, I composed the music, I created the cassette, I published the music. No one can claim ownership of this. Not that somebody wouldn't try it. So, here we go. So we'll put it into play. So, let's see. The volume controls on the machine work. Okay, and I can tell from just listening to that, because I know this music, this machine is running slow. It's probably running slow because it needs new belts. So we'll try to do a fast forward with it. Motor's spinning, but nothing's moving. Try to do a rewind. Motor's spinning, nothing's doing anything. So we definitely need to take a look at the inside of the machine and find out what's going on with the belts. Stay tuned. This unit is typical of some construction where in order to work on the machine you really have to take the whole thing completely apart. I've seen that before. It's not a serious problem. So the first thing I did was I took the screws on the side here out so that I could take the cassette door off. That's necessary to get to these screws that were located inside here. And I put the screws back in so I won't lose them. Now there are screws all over this thing, and I've taken them all out and put them very carefully into a holder so that I know which screws came from where. These came from the back, these came from the front part here, and these are the screws that were working through here to hold the unit together. So now this part can lift out, revealing the inside of the tape recorder. It's not really a recorder, it's just a player. It could have been a tape recorder, and we're going to see why in a minute. Let me show you a couple points here. Here is the main drive belt for the machine, and you can see it's pretty loose. This is going to have to be replaced. And I can date this machine approximately the late 1970s, early 80s, because there are gears in here. And this is when they were transitioning between using all friction drive and gear drive. Nowadays, almost everything is gear drive. The only belt drive is a capstan flywheel. We can now lift this off, and we want to lift this very carefully because it is wired. And you can see the wire right here. You see that? And that wire simply runs the little LED to tell you the machine is on or off. So we want to be very careful not to rip that wiring out. We also can see, if you take a look on the other side, we can lift this out. And now we can see the upper part of the deck. And this is very different from what was being done in the 1960s and early 1970s. So it's going to take a little bit of work to figure out how all these parts work together. I want to get them out and clean them, and then put the thing back together with a new belt, and this is going to be just as right as rain. Now we have, why is rain right? Anyway, we have something unusual here. There's a microphone. And that's why I said this could have been a tape recorder, because there is a microphone here, and there's a reason why they put it in there, which we will look at in a little while once we get through. But there's a single playhead here, and an automatic shutoff mechanism here, but there's no erase head. So this machine is definitely a player, but it could have been if they had wanted it to do it. If they had just added a little bit more circuitry and a couple more parts, this could have been a tape recorder. In fact, they may have made a tape recorder just like this and sold it as a recorder and then sold this unit as a player, since both were popular at the time. So the next thing I have to do is get the capstan out and see what I can do with these mechanisms here so I can clean them. Now I've removed the capstan thrust plate here. It's just two screws that hold it in, and I've put the screws back in place so that I won't lose them. And this will allow me to lift the capstan and belt assembly out. So what I do is I simply take the belt, pull it off the motor, and then hold it to the side and hold it tight to the capstan flywheel. And the reason is that this flywheel is right up against the circuit board. So to pull the whole thing out, I just have to keep it tight and lift. And there is the small capstan flywheel, and here is the loose belt. And you can tell from looking at the belt, not sure how clear this is if I hold it up there, it's been used quite a bit, and it is time for replacement. And this is an orbicular belt, which they call them. They're square in cross-section, and they fit in a groove right here in the capstan flywheel. It's a very small little capstan flywheel, but I bet it's probably pretty efficient. And there's also a notch here on the capstan flywheel, and that engages the auto shutoff mechanism. So we'll put that down for cleaning and look at some of the other things that need to come out in order to be cleaned and cared for. The fast forward and rewind are managed by this idler here. Now that's a friction idler because it has a rubber tire on it, and the rubber tire engages the capstan flywheel itself. Now you notice how the capstan flywheel is able to spin with no problems because there's absolutely nothing interfering with it right now. When I put it into fast forward, watch this idler. As you can see, the idler moved over slightly, so it's pressing against the capstan flywheel. You see, I cannot turn this very easily at all. And it is also, because it has a gear underneath it, engaging this large gear here. That large gear is permanently affixed to the take-up table. So this is how they accomplish fast forward. And if there's any slippage between the flywheel and this tire, the fast forward is going to be affected because obviously the gears can't slip. Let's put it in stop and see what happens in rewind. In rewind, the tire moves this way slightly, but again gets caught between the flywheel and an idler gear located here, which engages another gear located here. You probably can't see it. This gear located here is part of the feed table. So at this point in time, while the capstan is turning, it's turning the idler gear, and the feed table. So that would manage rewind. Now if I try to spin the capstan with my thumb, you can see we're not getting anything. Something is not engaging properly. Now this is a clutch mechanism here, so there's a clutch between this tire and the gear that's underneath it. This is going to have to be repaired. Now if I try to run it by hand from underneath, you can see I can make it work, but it's very, very stiff. So there's a problem somewhere in the clutch and gearing system that needs to be either oiled or just readjusted. Another thing that I found is on the case itself, and there's a hairline crack right here in the case. Now that I can fix very easily by just putting in some super glue and sealing up that crack. So my job now is to get this mechanism here apart for examination and repair. We're looking at the take-up table assembly here, which I have removed. There are two screws here and here that lock the plate down. Removing those, I can get the take-up assembly out. Now, the take-up assembly actually consists of several parts, which are very complicated to work on. If you see here, it's very hard to tell, but there's a spring in the back. Now, I've removed the retaining clip, so now I can lift this out. And here is the spring that is located for probably for back tension when you're in rewind, and also to make the tape wind evenly. This gear is driven by the fast forward clutch mechanism that we looked at earlier, and this tire is for the standard take up, and it has a friction clutch mechanism itself, and that is so that the tape can work with the capstan and not stretch. This just simply needs a cleaning and regreasing, and this will be ready to go. The parts are clean now, and I did find another problem. You remember that I showed you the clutch mechanism that works the fast forward and rewind, and this is the mechanism all taken apart. This is the drive wheel, this is the clutch spring, this is the gear that sits under the drive wheel. The clutch spring presses the drive wheel against that gear so that there's friction, and this is a retaining collar to make the whole thing stay together. This is what has the problem. This retaining collar has a crack right here. So I'm going to have to seal up that crack using super glue so that we can get this thing to work again. The clutch mechanism here is holding together with the super glue, and I also super glued the spring around the clutch so that it will hold the clutch, the top part of the clutch, tight. How long this will last, I cannot guarantee. This type of plastic usually does not work very well with super glue, but it seems to be working so far. If I put it in rewind and I turn the spindle, you can see that it is turning, the gears are all working. And if I put it in fast forward and turn the spindle, you can see it's all working. Now the test is to put in a capstan and see if it is able to move the capstan. So to do that, I simply lift this out a little bit, slip the capstan into place temporarily, push the collar back down, and I'll put it in rewind. And you can see that as I spin the spindle, the capstan turns, and as the capstan turns, it's spinning the spindle, and I can feel the friction there. So it's definitely holding it. And the same thing with fast forward. It's a little bit awkward to show you this, but again, it is definitely gripping. So the next step is to oil the capstan, put in the new belt, and give it a run. Now, I found a replacement belt. This is the old belt, which you can tell by the misshapenness of it, and this is a fresh new belt. And the new belt is smaller. It should be smaller because it has not stretched. I have the belt in place and the machine is running. I'm using an external power source. The thrust plate is not on right now, but it is moving in the correct direction and everything. And this is in playback. Now let's go to fast forward. We're doing this in Q, and we'll put it into stop. And there it is in fast forward. And if I grab from below, I can feel a lot of pull. So the friction clutch mechanism is working, but we have plenty of strength. Now we'll go to rewind. Same thing, testing it. And we have plenty of strength, so we know that everything is functioning well. And the rewind and fast forward are working. A little bit of oil for the capstan. Put back the thrust plate, and this looks like it's a go. So taking my Symphonia Felina cassette, I sell this on the internet. You can get the cassette or the CD of this wonderful synthesizer music inspired by the love of a cat. And that's Clyde Big Paws, for whom ClydeSight is named. Put the tape in. Now obviously you won't be able to hear it because I haven't plugged in the speakers, but we can see that it is definitely, the tape is running, everything is there. Put in fast forward, and there we go, plenty of fast forward. Put it in rewind, plenty of rewind. Let's see about cue and review. So I've got it playing. Now we'll go for a cue. Okay, and then we'll go for a review. The machine is back together, and I'm going to show you how to polish the case. What you need is a can of this product here. This is called WD-40, and you need a paper towel, a couple of paper towels here. And what you do is you spray your WD-40 very closely onto the paper towel because you don't want to splatter. And you just need a little bit, not much. And then you just start rubbing the case with the WD-40. Now, WD-40 is very useful because it cleans as well as polishes the plastic. WD-40 is a petroleum product, plastic is a petroleum product, so the two of them are very, very compatible. I've been cleaning tape recorders for years with WD-40 and I've always had success. Now, after it's sat for a minute, which allows the plastic to absorb as much oil as it wants, you take a dry towel and you just rub it, you buff it, just like you would polish a piece of furniture. This is the input for the 6-volt auxiliary power. And so I'm plugging in my jack. Your jack may be different if you have an adapter, but what this jack allows me to do is lean the machine back a little bit, which is kind of nice. And I'll plug in the speakers, because obviously you're not going to be able to hear this through the headphones. And I'm going to push the play button. Now, while this music plays, I'm going to pull a little bit of a digital audio trick. I'm going to take this machine into the other room when I make the video edits, and I'm going to feed it directly into the computer sound card so you can hear the quality of sound that this actually does put out, which you do hear through the headphones, but you don't hear through these speakers going through the camera mic. There's one other aspect I want to talk about on this machine, and that is right here. And this is an orange button that says hotline. Now, what that actually is there's a microphone on the front here, and Ken has told me about what this does, and shout out goes to Bad Edit Pro, who also explained it. The hotline allows this microphone to override what you're hearing on the tape. And there's a reason for that. And that is when you have the headphones on and surrounding your ears, or you cannot hear, sometimes you need to hear what's going on around you. So if you were listening to this machine and you saw some kind of commotion, you could push this button and the microphone would immediately come on. Now, there's no automatic circuit or anything with this. It's just controlled by the volume controls here. So you kind of have to turn the volume controls pretty far down or you'll get a real blast out of it. Now, this is also useful because if you've got two people listening on the headphone jacks, they're kind of tethered together and they may want to discuss what's going on in the music or say, you know, rewind that, I really like that, or fast forward, I'm bored. They'd be shouting at each other over the music through the headphones if they didn't have this feature here. So what one of them could do is just simply push the button down and then say something, and the microphone would pick it up. Now, obviously, the speakers here are very close to the machine, so I'm going to move the speakers back quite a ways. And I've got the volume way down here, but I'll show you how it works. You won't be able to hear it the way you would in headphones, but you press play. And you hear how it muted. So you can hear how when I was tapping it, the microphone was working. Now, obviously, I could not turn that way up because I'd get howling through the speakers from feedback, which you don't get that so much with the headphones. Although some headphones actually will give you the feedback howling also. Anyway, this completes the restoration of this particular machine. The rewind is working fine. The fast forward is working fine. I just thought of something. When you push the stop button, notice this LED. It comes on. Even though nothing is running, the stop button actually powers the machine. So that would be a way you could test your batteries before actually pressing play. Not sure how useful that is, but it is a feature of the machine. So that completes the restoration on this very interesting Montgomery Ward Stereo Cassette Player. Not exactly a Walkman, just something completely different. And I hope that the machine will give you many years of pleasure to come. Thanks for watching the video.